So, my name is Felix Simonis. I am a PhD candidate here at the Technical University of Munich. As I mentioned before, I am mainly working on code maintainability and code quality, and also do dynamic adaptive meshes as my PhD topic. So I will present you what we've achieved so far in this current version. Also, how to painlessly, this very important, painlessly upgrade from one of your ancient versions you probably use to the PSOS 2.0. And then upcoming features, which include the major features, which are mainly PhD driven, and the minor features that are important enough to be mentioned here. So I grouped the features into three, let's call them categories. They are not very, they're not partitions, let's call it that, like that. We have features like the two-level initializations and things like this, which impact you directly. We have usability, which is important for your sanity. And then later, building and packaging. Well, Paul talked a bit about SPAC and the entire XSDK related stuff, but also about what we did with the repository and how we decided to manage and version the bindings and adapters and all of this. So one of the killer features of Precise, or at least the version 2, is the two-level initialization. This means that we have an extended initialization which becomes more complex, but does not require to gather the mesh on the master of your parallel participant. Also, yeah, parallel participant. So before this, your mesh size was limited by the nodes, the memory on your main node, where the master was located on. This is not the case anymore. So this allows for extremely huge mesh cases, but it does not yet cover all corner cases. This is why we disable this by default. So we can enable it using the M2N use to level init on. This talk sadly won't happen due to medical problems. So yeah, you can just talk to us. As mentioned before, Miriam knows a lot about it, Benjamin knows a lot about it, and I can help you too, to understand this a bit more. Another bigger step forward is our continuous path towards a faster initialization. This is always the biggest, well, let's say, it is the biggest the part of Precise where we burn a lot of resources and have the most problems. So especially in the case of nearest projection mappings, we have to shift around a lot of well, mesh information. So by getting rid of some older baggage, we were able to completely refactor these entire mesh classes, which result in dramatically fewer allocations and a reduced memory footprint. And we gain a lot of locality, which wasn't design-wise wasn't possibly before. So we have a speed of the non of the communication, the computational parts, so non-communication parts of about 2. How much this will impact you depends on your mesh sizes. And another big feature, especially for users like you, is that we have now an XML reference that's actually readable. The one before was yeah, and it was very long on our to-do list to completely renew this. So we wrote a markdown generator for this. So now your XML reference, you can generate it yourself via our bin precise. Just call it with MD. Or you can go to Precise Wiki XML reference, and we have a complete, all up-to-date version of the reference there. We have descriptions of all the tags and examples and how to configure them. We tell you how to use the attributes, and also list you an give you a list of valid subtags with links so you can easily go through, and it makes the entire pre-sales experience way more comfortable. Another big part in features that goes already a bit again towards usability is that we have a unified configuration, meaning you have one configuration file now for serial and for parallel runs. Before, you had to define your master tag for parallel runs yourself. Now we imply a master MPI single tag. Also, we had the two separate cases that if you decided to go for radial basis function mappings, we had the RBF mappings and the PATSI variants of those. So now, if you decide to run one of your participants in parallel, pre-sales will automatically pick the PATSI variants of the respective RBF variant that you picked in your config. Also, because this is now all implied, we can also get rid of the distribution time in the M2N. So this is no longer required, and we remove that too. So the bottom line here is you have to keep less in your head when you work with pre-sales, and you can just use it, and it's very, very comfortable if you want to debug bigger cases. So we also simplified the API a bit. At some point, we realized that we had an inconsistency between bindings and the C++ API. The main problem here was that you could construct the solve interface and then use it somehow without even configuring it. There's no logical edge between the between the solve interface and any other thing in the entire interface that you could call without calling configure. So we decided to merge the two. This again gives you the opportunity to keep less information in your head, as there's less state in the interface. And that's always good. Also, we clarified some naming. There is this strange tech called post-processing, which has different meanings in our community. This was a mistake back then. And we decided to finally break, we took advantage of the 2.0 and renamed this, which was, of course, a breaking change. Then also, in conjunction with the continuous time interpolation, we got rid of an ambiguity. That doesn't matter. We used timestamp in a few different meanings, which we now corrected and use time window in most of the cases. More on that later. Also, we had some strange cases where we used vocabulary that was very weird to understand and very misleading. So like this fulfilled action, we renamed that. And going down this vocabulary route, we renamed some options in the geometric filters. Again, more on that later. So another big step forward is the config visualizer, which Makis introduced this morning in the hands-on session. We had the problem that it was very, very difficult to debug configuration, especially when you have a lot of meshes and you shift a lot of data around. So at some point, I decided to take on this problem and produce a little visualizer that outputs some dot graph, so you can use this in your thesis too, if you like. The interesting part is you can disable information that's not relevant to your specific use case, and by this reduce this graph here to what's actually important to you. If you want to know about very interesting use cases, ask Keith. Okay. Also, we are an XSDK member since the version 0.5.0, which was released in November. This basically means for you that we promise compatibility with all the major HPC relevant software libraries like PATSI and many other ones. It also means that we are now dedicated in maintaining a SPAC package, so you can use SPAC, the package manager for high performance computing, if you haven't heard of it, to install pre-sales there, you always got the newest version, and you can also fine-tune with different dependencies, different compilers, and it's very easy to switch. We are also, or at least the 1.6.1 version of Presize is also part of the XSDK, XSDK version 0.5.0. It means that we'll most likely be pre-installed on supercomputers in the future. So this is also a big upside for US users. Then we improved building and testing. We got a lot of negative comments that we follow the CMake standards, and if you build Presize from source, this can result in strange configurations, so non-optimized, non-debug configurations, which is a nightmare for teaching. So we fixed this. We now use debug as a default, which is a small but let's say important step forward. Also, for users of Intel compilers, we added some C++11 library checks. As you may know, Intel detects your GCC library at runtime, so it is a big pain to make sure that you're actually using C++11 compliant standards library. So we added the necessary checks for this, as we had already a lot of issues also when we tried to get into the XSDK. Furthermore, we restructured and clarified output, so your first impression of Presize will be a positive one, hopefully. And we group tests by components, so if something goes wrong, you can tell us something went wrong in the XML parsing or something like that. Then as next step, we also clarified CMake variables. They are not prefixed, and we don't use the old naming schemes anymore, so we tell you what they actually do. This became more and more important, as, for example, we had always this Python option where most of the users thought it would enable the Python bindings, but it had nothing to do with Python bindings, but Presize allows you to provide custom Python actions that you can use after or before mapping. And this was actually featured disenabled, so we now completely renamed the options to make them more understandable and readable. Also, because they're prefixed, they're nicely grouped in the CMake GUI, which may be interesting for normal users or Windows users. Also, now we come to a bigger part. We restructured our repository because we ended up in a problem with all the different bindings we had in there, that they were actually not really related to our code. And if we wanted to fix something in the bindings, we had to increase the version of Presize, which didn't really make sense. And it became more and more of a problem, also with all the different Python bindings we had, and then the MATLAB bindings, and Fortran, and so on and so forth. So we took an additional step and completely restructured the repository based on the Pitchfork layout by Colby Pike from the C++ Standards Working Group 21. And the interesting parts for you is that we put all the solver dummies into the examples directory, which we install. So when you install Presize via a Debian package, for example, you have all the solver dummies on your system, and you can use those to test your installation, and you can also use those as a start to develop your own adapters. Furthermore, we have two further directories. This sounds a bit trivial, but it's actually important. We have tools, which contain now the developer tools, and extras, which contain the user-relevant tools. So you as a user just head to extras, and you'll find interesting things there. Yeah, on the right-hand side, you see what you can do now with after an installed Debian package. You can just go somewhere and just configure your solver dummy and to just test if Presize works. So because we removed the bindings from the repository, we moved into different repositories. This includes everything except our native bindings. Native bindings is what we call the bindings that we compile into the library. namely C and Fortran. So they stay in the repository and they are versioned with Presort itself. Then we decided to remove the Fortran 2003 module and shift that into a separate repository. We also, after a very long time, finally have an official release of our Python bindings. This was a long journey, but it is here. So you can either head to the Python bindings repository, or you can use pip to install them. This requires that you install Presize though. It will just use your system installation. So keep this in mind. If you have multiple installations in parallel, this will most likely break this. Furthermore, we finally have MATLAB bindings. So this is a big new announcement in that respect. What this means for you is that you have one place where you can find the bindings, where you can find examples, where you can find the complete documentation relevant to those, and we can actually separately release those bindings and create bug fixes without impacting the entire Presize repository. So this was the what happened guide and also part, and now comes the porting guide. This is the guide that's the most important for those that still stick, also decided to stick with old versions of Presize because they didn't want to upgrade and break things. The porting guide can be found on the wiki. It consists out of three parts. The first one is building, the second one is API, and the third one is configuration. So with building, remove scones, forget about it, and use CMake. We do not support scones anymore and will not answer to any requests about this other than switch to CMake. It's the only sane version, also the only sane way forward. Then we changed the CMake variables from the old choice to the newer, more expressive ones. So this is what you have to do. Then second, we have the API. As I mentioned before, we decided to merge the configuration into the construction. So this is a two-line change. Then is time step complete. Renate this to is time window complete, and at last we have the fulfilled action, which was a very strange choice in the first place. We renamed this to mark action fulfilled, which now actually tells you what it does. And the third part is configuration. This is a bit more verbose. The first one is to just remove all master MPI single tags because they're implied, you don't need them anymore. The upside is if you do this, your code will actually run in serial too. Then remove the distribution type for your M2N tags and also rename post-processing to acceleration. Then for the options, we have this neat little table here, or the two, where the most of the options or the most of the renames are due to the fact that we renamed this time step to time window. So that's basically all the above. And then at the bottom you can see the use mesh, the geometric filter of the use mesh, which was which expressed time before, which was very difficult to understand if you didn't read all the papers about Presize and the parallel initialization, or the parallel partitioning. And we now tell you where the filtering is being done. So either on the slaves or on the master, which is a bit more, it's easier to understand. Okay, so that was the part about 2.0. Now we come to the roadmap. We have two major features, feature groups that we distinguish. We have the major upcoming features, which are normally PHD driven. So you have one primary developer that you can contact, and this developer has a personal goal to drive this forward. This is always a long time goal, as it is structured around a complete PhD, so 3 years or something like this. And because this is scientifically driven, collaboration is always welcome. So if you have interesting use cases for this, reach out to us or reach out to the respective developer. Then the second part are minor anticipated features. Those are not scheduled. They are relatively small normally, but they are, let's say we don't have always time to do them straight away, so we keep them in a backlog And sometimes we transform this into a student topic, either just like a project or a complete thesis. That's possible too. Here, if you can think of additional features that you would like, open an issue, and if you would like to contribute, you're of course welcome to contribute. Yeah, so now we come to the major features. The first one is the two-level parallel initialization by Amin Tohtafurrush. Yes, so we, as I said, there are some limitations, that's why we don't enable it by default. Our goal is to cover all corner cases, test this thing extensively, and then enable it by default. So this is sounds quite trivial, but it is, there's actually a lot of work to be done still. As I said, sadly, the talk mentioned below won't happen today. But, hopefully, it's at some point in the future. Then, by Gerasimos Shadakis, we have the geometric multiscale mapping, which is a mapping between dimensions, so 1D, 2D, 1D, 3D. The idea is to have a physically meaningful mapping. There are many use cases like CFD and reactor safety and things like this. There will be no talk about this, but there was an interesting talk at the Open Foam workshop, and you can find the slides from this talk in MediaTum, and you can find, of course, Gerasimos Makis here in the room. Yeah. So next is the thesis by Benjamin Rudd. His topic is consistent time interpolation, where we try to provide you a way or method to not only interpolate in space, but also in time. So you can now basically, so Precise internally builds an interpolant, and you can use this to fetch data for any t, and this makes this entire implicit coupling way more efficient if you can make use of it. So this feature, the interesting part about this feature is that it should be completely invisible to the user. And yeah, so there will be a talk tomorrow at 10 o'clock about Benjamin Root. So you'll probably, hopefully, be still mentally fit for this. Next is my topic, this dynamic adaptive meshes. The idea here is to reset the mesh on demand and allow redefining potentially at every time step. So this also has many, let's say that the Precise currently is built on the assumption that meshes are static, so that you can derive communication patterns for new meshes and the mappings. And this this changes the fundamental method, also fundamental assumption of the complete library. So this is, sounds quite easy, but it is in big. It is a big modification of the entire library. The result of this will hopefully, in the first step, be adaptive meshes or support for adaptive meshes at the interface boundary, that the solver interface, and the other one would be to have full support for dynamic meshes in the future. Then again, now we come to the minor anticipated features where I mentioned that contributions are welcome. You can go to the contributes side of the Precise repository and check out the different issues that we have open, which is quite interesting to have a look at. Yep. So the first one is nearest projection for volume coupling. You can do volume coupling at the moment with Precise. With the two-level initialization, this became quite, this became computationally bearable, and now we still need to fix or to adjust nearest projection mapping that you can project to two and three dimensional elements without by telling it that you should not project on an interface but project on volume. So this needs some changes internally, and we then also have to logically have to add 3D elements, otherwise this makes no sense, right? Then the next one is support for quads, something we currently do not support, or not fully. The problem here is that hexahedral meshes are quite common. Even if you know the Stanford Bunny is a hexahedral mesh, so it's one of the standard meshes. you can find. So the big questions here is if you have an unstructured quad, how do you project on this? What's the surface there? How do you define it? And how does the user define this? These are all non-trivial questions that we have to ask ourselves, find a solution to this and implement. And then as a last result, there's always a question, is internal triangulation a viable option for this? Then another, it's not a big problem, but it's a nuisance. If you have perfectly matching meshes and if you can guarantee that your vertices are in the same order on both participants, which is actually very common case if you come from a file-based coupling software or coupling mode, then currently in Prisys you have to use a nearest neighbor mapping, which will still build an spatial index tree based on your mesh, and then start finding nearest neighbors, which is quite quite expensive thing to do, even if it's just finding the nearest from one to the other. So what we came up with is that if you can guarantee us that you register your vertices in the same order on both sides, so just the vertex order, not some other order, term of registration, then this complete mapping can be reduced to finding subranges in this and just copying data from some input into some output buffer. So this can be then super efficient and super fast. Then something that's also missing is bulk functions for setting connectivity information in meshes. So this is at the moment edges triangles, but it will be if we add 3D elements, we also have tetrahedra and all of that. So the big point here is that setting many edges from outside Prisys is very painful and very expensive, because Prisys has to do a lot of input sanitation, sanitization, and it has also to guarantee a consistent state between calls. So if you give us a lot of vertex IDs to set edges or a lot of triangles, so match IDs to set triangles, this will be vastly more efficient. So this is also in the pipeline. There's already a prototype for this, just needs testing. And then, as a last big point, is watch integrals. Currently, have watch points, so you can watch a point. But sometimes it might be interesting to watch the state over an integral over a complete mesh. And this is the prototype configuration for this. So like watching a total force on a geometry in FSI, or some flow rate in a fluid-fluid coupling. There was already quite some thought that went into this, and if you're interested in this, ask Benjamin Ilkermann for that. Also about that, yeah. So that's my part here. I hope you liked a little outlook on 2.0 and the little tools and all the thought we put into this. And also the sheer fact that we try to make upgrading as easy as possible. And that's it for me. Any questions? Yeah. We have the coffee break now, right? So we can also extend to that. Yeah. No. That's where this is the point where we found out that the breaking changes is not only breaking to the software, but also breaking to the developers. We had to basically rewrite everything, or the big parts of everything. So, but we provide adapters and bindings and everything for the new version. So if you plan to upgrade, you're good to go. Right. Yeah? The old implementation in the old documentation. Which documentation? Pardon? The wiki? Yes. Well, you can actually, as our wiki is on GitHub, you can always check it out and then revert and then have a look at it. Yeah. No. For obvious reasons. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah. This is the moment where I would hand over to Benjamin here. Other questions? Well done. Yeah. Yes. So this is also part of the 2.0 that we removed this, because this was actually possible before, but it was fundamentally broken. And I think just no one really used it, so no one really noticed. So we removed it now. Back, also in the future, when I will be implementing dynamic meshes, then we need this feature, so this is also part of my thesis, to come up with a proper way to do this. Yeah. Okay, other questions?